Loans are important. In fact, there isn't any country in the world today that isn't, you know, in one way or the other, have borrowed money or are in loan. Apparently, those loans are used to develop the country, at least where people would feel that they have a country that have been holding the loans in trust for them. And so because of that, so many countries go all out in different forums and different places to, you know, borrow monies in order to develop an infrastructure within their territories. But how far has these loans that countries, especially on the African continent, have borrowed, have actually done in terms of development? Has it really done well, or have we squandered our opportunity to use our loans to better our lives? We have with us live in the studio a journalist who would throw some insight into loans and how much of our loans that we have used, the judicious use to our development. We have Mr. Mike Ubani. Good to have you. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. You're welcome.
Thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me. Thank you, our listeners.
Loans are important.
Yes.
I mean, there isn't any country you could say that doesn't, you know, go for loans. Yeah. America, in fact, is the most indebted country in the world.
Yeah.
But again, you'd wonder, when these loans come, are they really loans used for the reasons why they are actually even, mm-hmm. you know, gotten?
Yeah.
But I just wanted to ask you, for you, from your own standpoint, mm-hmm. with what we have received in terms of loans so far, up until this moment,
yeah.
do you think there's a commensurate development in terms of infrastructure, in terms of education, to what we have right now?
Thank you very much. You've said it all, that a loan is a universal phenomenon. I mean, it's not something that you can say is peculiar to one country, peculiar to one continent. Nigeria, African continent as a whole, I mean, in the world, countries take loans, expand the frontiers of their economy. Nigeria's public debt stock surged to 134.3 trillion, naira. That's about 91.3 billion dollars by the end of the second quarter of 2024, and you can see that we are in the club of borrowing. But if you look at our developmental trajectory, you will find out that the money that we have borrowed so far, you cannot say much money we have borrowed over the years. It has done a great job in terms of developing the several sectors of Nigeria's economy. I and you cannot put food on the table. Our roads are still bad. The health sector, the education sector, are still in a state of disrepair. There is high level of unemployment. The industrialization of Nigeria has been put to a halt. Many industries, many manufacturers have left the country, for all the countries that offer them a more favorable way to do business. So you can see that we have not accounted responsibly for the humongous amount of money we have borrowed over the years. Like I said, most of our roads are still not as accessible, motorable. There is hunger in the land, there is a food crisis, there is energy crisis, there is a huge unemployment. Our students go to school, they qualify, they come out, and there's no job for them. So you ask yourself, where have these loans gone into? Well, we are still borrowing. Of course, you know it. When you borrow to increase investment. You borrow to increase savings, which ultimately comes to expansion of your national income, expansion of the level of employment. But you can see that the unemployment level is rising. National income is coming down. inflation is high, food prices are high, cost of living is high, you know, so you don't know where these loans have gone to. And a country like Nigeria, you know, that is infested with corruption, you know, one can have an idea where it is, you know, because you cannot talk about development of any country when there is monumental, you know, corruption going on in the system. So it's possible that some of these loans have been gone to private pockets, and that's why we are not feeling the effect of these loans. And it makes one wonder whether it is appropriate, whether it is you know, good for us to continue borrowing. Isn't it possible for us to look inwards, to raise capital for us to finance our budgets, for us to revitalize and shore up the economy? So in essence, what one is saying in effect is that the loans have not reflected on our, you know, standard of living, on the level of development, on the industrial sector, the, you know, in almost all the sectors, you know, we can, one can think about. Fuel prices are high. They tell us about revitalization of our refineries, taking so much money. I'm sure that the money that they put into the turnaround maintenance of our refineries came from loan. And how many of these refineries are working? You know, so for me, I think we have not done well in the area of utilizing our loans judiciously.
Well, it's barely just 2 weeks for this approval, this particular approval.
Mm.
So do you think is enough time, you know, for you to begin to see
infrastructure? No. What, you have to look at what happened in the past. If you look at what happened in the past, because if we had used, I'm saying if we had used the previous loans judiciously, I mean, there's nobody will, you know, complain about the need to borrow more money. But yes, 2 weeks for approval. What have we done, or what did we do with the previous loans that we obtained? If the previous loans were used judiciously, we will not be where we are today. But like you said, borrowing is a universal phenomenon, and Nigeria as a country, nobody will hold you, nobody will accuse you, nobody will ask you not to borrow, because I mean it's a universal thing. But what do you do with the money you borrow? That is the issue.
How much of this borrowing do you think will impact the debt profile of Nigeria,
positively or negatively?
Both ways. I'm just asking you. You think it would in any way impact the debt profile of the country? I mean, you mentioned the debt profile of Nigeria some years back.
Yes.
Do you think it will impact it?
It has positively? It has never impacted positively on the, you know, the economy. And so what we have is a situation where every money you are borrowing, even the ones you are going to borrow tomorrow, the ones you are referring to that was borrowed and approved, you know, 2 weeks back, is not impacting. Has not nothing has. There's nothing to show on the table that, you know, this loan, you know, remember after the Second World War, you know, America, European countries borrowed money, you know, to develop their economy because there was much devastation. You can see where they are today. Okay, since independence, we've been trying, you know, of course, at a point in Nigeria's history, we were not borrowing. We were even at the point, General Gowon, when he was military head of state, he said, our problem is not money, but how to spend the money. You can see that there was no borrowing at that point in time. In fact, the federal government under the military regime paid the salaries of the workers of some countries. I'll show you how buoyant Nigeria was then, and that will tell you that we had no need to borrow money. But these days, because of the monumental recklessness in the use of public funds, Nigeria is subjected to borrowing on a yearly basis, on a quarterly basis, you know, and we have not seen the impact on my life, on your life, and the lives of the generality of Nigerians.
Hmm. Some quarters argue that these loans are not just invested in developing the country, like you said, rather that they borrow for themselves and leave, you know, Nigeria to pay, which is killing the Nigerian economy. Would you agree with them, or would you, you know, have any contrary opinion?
No, I agree with them now, because the burden of our generation, we may not be the people paying for those loans, but we are suffering because of the fact that those loans were not used for the purposes for which they were meant for. We are suffering, but the coming generation, we have to pay for these. So it's a deferred burden, is a deferred financial burden on the coming, the later generation of Nigerians, you know. So for me, something must be done, and one of the things that something must be done to ensure that every kobo we borrow, is accounted for, you know. And again, if you look at the fluctuation of the Nigerian currency against the fall of the Nigerian currency against the dollar, you agree with me that the money you borrowed today, assuming that $1 exchanges for 1,700 naira today, the $1 you borrowed today will not be the same
$1 you pay tomorrow.
$1 in exchange of the naira that you pay tomorrow. So As the years go by, and there is inability to pay, and your economy is not becoming strong. In fact, you know, one of the purposes of borrowing is to shore up the economy, make the economy strong. But we are borrowing. We're not seeing anything. The economy is not becoming strong. I mean, there is so much suffering in the land. So at the end of the day, we are going to pay more in naira terms, okay? You know, to service those loans and pay for the principal of, you know, those loans. So we're going to pay more. The burden is for the future generations to clear these loans, except in the situation where, like General Obasanjo, President Obasanjo did when he was here, and Okonjo Iweala worked assiduously to give the IMF and the other international monetary organizations to cancel our debts. And that was a good one for us. But after that, we kept accumulating public debts, and which is not salutary, you know, to the Nigerian economy.
Some of these borrowed funds are put into different sectors of the economy. We talk about agriculture, education, and the likes. And over the years, we haven't really accounted for these monies, like you mentioned. It hasn't impacted positively in the lives of people. I mean, how do you think accountability can be infused? And so much so that when monies are allocated, these borrowed monies are allocated to certain things or certain places, and if the results doesn't come out, we'll have someone to hold responsible. Mm-hmm. How do we get into the accountability of loans that we collect for certain infrastructure facilities?
Yeah, well, let's start with the work that the Economic and Financial Crimes Commission is doing. And, you know, if you are in government, if you borrow money and the money, you can't account for the money, and the money is not judiciously used. This is when the EFCC comes in to ask questions. And, you know, from the system, or from what we have seen over the years, yes, somebody could, like what we see in Yahya Bello's case. That case may be in court for 10 years, 20 years. And at a point, we may forget that, you know,
or something like that.
That something like that happened. So we have to, make sure that our institutions, for instance, the EFCC, is very strong. and the EFCC is determined to fight against crime. The way they are doing it, even when you know that somebody has stolen, there is evidence to show that somebody has stolen, the person will use, half, not just one quarter of the money that he has stolen to buy the case, in court, and the case continues, adjournment and all that. What I'm saying, in fact, is that for accountability, for us to make sure that every kobo we borrowed is accounted for, the EFCC or our other institutions that are responsible for fighting financial crime should be strong or stronger than what they are today. And any report of financial malfeasance or misappropriation of funds must be followed diligently.
You're talking about after the deed has been done.
Yes.
So what about modalities that can stop someone from even stealing it in the first place? Because like you mentioned, it is only somebody who has enough money that can buy a judge over a case. So can even buy the EFCC personnel that have come to even arrest them. Mm-hmm. Because we've seen that play out in some quarters. EFCC had to even go as far as dismissing some of their staff because they collected bribe over some of these corruption issues. So is it not possible that we can, stop the stealing first before it goes over to when EFCC starts as this beam
light? I agree totally with you that we need to stop them before they commit the crime. All right, and from what we have seen, EFCC is not fast in pursuing, a financial crime-related cases. Yes, I agree with you. There needs to be a change of mind among Nigerians.
How do you think we can do that?
Especially those working in the civil service, because you cannot commit financial crime without involving the civil servants. They are they know how to manipulate figures and how to rewrite and write records, papers, So there must be the spirit of patriotism, the spirit of nationalism in us, especially among those who are holding public offices. If you love your country, why would you want to steal from your country? It's because of the love of the country is not there. That's why when you are put in a sensitive position, or where you are holding government, or you are looking for what to steal, because you don't love your country. If we love Nigeria, if we are interested in development of this country, if you are saying, to hell with going to America, going to UK, going to Canada and all that, develop what is in our land, develop what is in the country. If that love patriotism is there, if that spirit of patriotism, spirit of nationalism is there, there will be less of stealing in our system. I think we have to do that. And again, the leaders at the different levels of of government, federal, state, and local government, should show example. Okay, they should show example by one of the things they should do is to reduce the cost of governance. I mean, you think that when you go into government look, let me tell you. You see, those, if you look at Nigeria, for instance, we are a consumptive nation. Consumption. Look at the big cars that we ride. You don't manufacture them. But those who manufacture those cars abroad, they don't ride on those vehicles. Rather, what they do is that they ride on small cars. All right? But Nigeria, we like things big. We like things expensive. So that test must be reduced. That test for high test living must be reduced. Like I said, the leadership must show example. They should cut down on the cost of governance. And when they do that, then it will trickle down. The followers will now know that there is seriousness on the part of our leaders you know, to build up Nigeria, to stop, to build Nigeria, to stop stealing and all that and all that. How do you explain a situation where a sitting governor will steal over 100 billion naira in 8 years? Or even for, because they can do this within 1 month or two years now. You know, what is left for the provision of water, for provision of good roads? And the public, the civilians, the masses are not asking for too much. They are not asking for too much. Just give us water, give us electricity, give us good roads, and you can go to sleep, all right? Yeah, but those things are not there. Yet our leaders, they keep borrowing, and they travel abroad and they see how developed those countries. Look at our transport system. It's not, you go to UK, and many of them, you see them riding on train when they go to UK. Mm-hmm. You see that most tube trains, if you ride in London, most tube trains, 3/4 of the people there on a particular day are Nigerians, but they come back and they cannot replicate such developmental strides in our country. So again, I'm pointing at the spirit of nationalism and patriotism. If our leaders are patriotic, most of the stealing that we find in our country will not be there, you know, in the first place. So there must be a rethink.
There was a comment you made before that people, the generation to come, are the ones that will pay for this. Does that mean that we are paying for the loans, for the effects of the loans being borrowed before?
Before, that's right. You are paying for it against the backdrop of the fact that the money tied to those projects was not used to on the specific projects that they were tied to. And here we are, you cannot ride on good roads. You cannot have uninterrupted electricity supply. You don't have potable water. You don't have, after your school, you are scouting around to get employment, and there's no employment there. That's how you are paying for it, okay? And in most states, in most cases, there is increase in taxes, okay? All right? The debate is going on reform, tax reform, bill, and all that, and all that, and all that. So when those monies are not used judiciously, you pay more tax, all right? And the people, the generation coming after us, they are going to carry the burden, you know? So, if you construct, look at this road, if you construct this road leading to this station today, are you going to do it tomorrow? I'm sure that the contract for this road construction was given some time ago. But here we are, look at what we are seeing. So what I'm saying in effect is that, yes, borrowing, like we have agreed, is a universal thing, is a universal phenomenon. But do you borrow to marry more wives?
Borrow to squander. Or do you borrow to squander, or you borrow to, you know, raise infrastructure? Another question that is always bothering my heart is, do countries really, really have to borrow? Why can't they, you know, basically generate what they have, use it, and give other aspects and other infrastructure development, and just live within the means of their income? Why do they have to borrow?
Borrowing is a business. It's a business. The people who
business for who now? Is it for the country or for the people?
Business for the people who have the money, and business for the people who are going to borrow. Officials who are going to borrow, and officials who are going to release the money.
But the question is, can a country basically live without borrowing?
Yes, if there is prudent financial management, you use what you have to get what you need. And I think Nigeria is in that position, to use what it has to get.
So why do countries borrow? If the country can actually survive without
corruption. Corruption. That's why they borrow, to enrich their private pockets, not to develop the infrastructure facilities in your country, not to increase national income, not to fight unemployment, not to reduce inflation, but to, when they tell you they have borrowed $2 billion, for instance, $1 billion is removed and put into private pockets.
Mm.
All right? How do you ask them? Who are you going to ask about the remaining money? You know, but next time they say, oh, let's borrow to finance deficit, our budget. Deficit budget. We want to build a railway line from Port Harcourt to Umuahia to Makurdi, you know, let's borrow. But what about the monies you borrowed? So once the issue of corruption is reduced to the barest minimum, we'll be able to finance what we are. You've traveled abroad, you know that those countries, they don't, I don't see any difference between Nigeria and UK. What is it that they have that we don't have here? So why do we rush to UK? Why do we rush to Dubai? What do they have? Dubai was a desert some 20 years back, all right? So it's because we are not committed to this land, this country called Nigeria, all right? That's why, you know, you steal, and instead of investing the money here, you take it abroad, you buy houses here and there, and you don't live in any of them, okay? So that love for the country must be instilled in us, especially among our leaders, for Nigeria to make progress. The way we are going, I'm sure that if we keep going, if we keep, you know, on this trajectory, in the next 10 years, 20 years, our country will still remain on the within the sphere of underdeveloped countries of the world.
Mm. Two questions I want to ask. This particular borrowing has, you know, triggered reactions. People are saying that Nigeria is now the giant of debt.
Yes, they're correct.
Yes, they're correct. And even Atiku Abubakar has come out to say that borrowing, this particular borrowing, is going to, you know, affect the economy of Nigeria. But I want to just read out the comment of the chairman of the committee who presented this particular loan to the Senate,
yes.
Aliyu Wamako. He said that the loan request will be utilized for the execution of the ongoing project and programs in the 2024 Appropriation Act, stressing that the projects were critical for national growth and development.
Mm.
Do you agree
with that? You ask yourself, is this the first time Nigeria is borrowing? What happened to the previous money that we borrowed? I am saying,
they said they want to use it for the execution of the project they have for
the
appropriation of 2024.
What about 2023? Didn't they have budget, projects to execute in that budget? What about 2022? The issue is that we are not, remember, we have agreed that borrowing is a universal phenomenon. You borrow to do things today that you would have done tomorrow. In other words, tomorrow is here, okay? I'm not mimicking this one now. So you borrow to do executive projects that you would have done tomorrow, you borrow to do it today. But when those projects are not executed, and there's nobody to account for the money, you know, so you keep on borrowing. Next year, this a similar request will be made to the National Assembly, and the National Assembly members will approve it. You won't see any critical voice. You won't hear any critical voice, against, the request for loan, because everybody, almost everybody in that cycle enjoys the benefits of borrowing. Okay? So we return to the question that Charles asked. If we decide not to borrow, Nigeria can survive using what we have to get what we need. We get to that position if our leaders are patriotic enough, we get to that position. And Nigeria has enough to sustain itself without going outside. It's only because borrowing is a business, like I said. Those who negotiate for the loan, they have their own court. You don't know.
And those who present the loan.
Those who present the loan, give the loans, have their own court. So it's a business. And the world continues. Okay. Next time they'll tell you, oh, we have a surplus of so amount of money in our, you know, it's like buying and selling. When you have a product, you advertise your product and people will buy. Those people with money, they will advertise that they have money. They have so much money, you know, in their till. Come and borrow. And because they know that if you borrow, the officials that do the, you know, paperwork will get some money. You get, I get, and the war continues. Borrowing continues. It never stops. But it's unfortunate that for us, we don't use that money judiciously to execute projects that they are meant for. Any day we decide you are borrowing $2.209 billion, the money is approved, you get the money, and the money is used for that purpose. You will see it. I will see it. That this project, this road was awarded, you know, and this is the money for it. It has been done. But everywhere you see projects, on abandoned projects littered everywhere. And they continue to borrow. They continue to borrow. So we need to put a stop to borrowing and see what we can do. See how we can use the resources at our disposal to develop our country.
All right. Mm. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
I truly, really appreciate you. I'm just going to ask, you know, wanted to ask one more question, but because of time, you just have to go. Maybe you can just throw it out in just 30 seconds. How should the public react to these kinds of borrowing?
The public should remonstrate, demonstrate, not violent demonstration, but keep asking questions. All right?
Okay.
Keep asking questions about the need to continue borrowing. Keep asking questions about where the money we borrowed in the past had gone to. You know, and if the public does that, I mean, they will put the leadership, you know, they will raise the consciousness of the leadership to
all
the extent that they said, oh, the leadership will say, oh, these people know that the money we are borrowing, we are not using it
properly.
You know, properly.
So
you know,
probing every time what exactly this money is being used.
You have to probe.
Okay.
You have to probe. But unfortunately, we are so docile in this country. If I am as an Igbo man, if I ask questions about where the money, they say, oh, they say, oh, this Igbo man is an ethnic question that he's asking. And
now
someone asks that question.
Let's leave it there.
The Yoruba man asks that question, it will be reduced to regional and ethnic, you know.
Let's leave it there, Mr. Mike. Many thanks for your time.
Thank you.
We truly appreciate
much.
It.
I wish this discussion. I wish you have more time to this discussion
because
it's a quite interesting discussion, really.
Yeah.
Nigerians ought to know that this borrowing is not helping us at all.
We're going to continue discussing these issues and with a view to finding solutions, at least to the extent of holding our leaders accountable to some of these monies that they're using on our behalf. Thank you once again.
Thank you very much for inviting me.
All right, we'll go for a short break and we'll come back. We'll bring you another discussion. We don't go anywhere.